Community TV's 2021 Medicine Hat Municipal Election coverage is sponsored by local businesses that support your access to relevant election information. The sponsors do not endorse the candidates or their ideas.
Hi, so my name is Andy McGrogan. I'm running for City Council. I'm a retired Chief of Police here in Medicine Hat. I joined the police service in 1980. And it was the last 12 years of my 40-year services as the Chief of Police. So because of that, I've got a fond liking to this city. It gave me my first opportunity in policing. I was working in the oil patch at 21. I was waiting. I'd applied with the Ontario Provincial Police where I'd grown up. I saw an ad in the paper, applied, and was successful. So I came out of, basically, I started my career with a high school education. And I kind of worked on some undergrad studies through my time on the police service, eventually built into a master's program through Royal Roads, and I have a master in leadership and adult training. And actually, in the last couple of years as the chief, I took a graduate course in executive coaching, so more or less leadership coaching. So that's kind of my educational background. Obviously, my time as the chief of police, I had a lot of experience with things like civic budgets and, you know, although we're at arm's length to city council, we did most of our work with the commission, and then of course the, you know, kind of the final numbers would go to council. But quite familiar with our city, how they work, and again, it's really a way for me to give back. I've had a great career in my policing career. I've had about 6 months in retirement, and I thought what a great way to give back for a 4-year term. So that's kind of my background. I have my wife is from Medicine Hat. I had two children. My son lives in Calgary, and I have a daughter who's passed. So that's kind of my my background, and been enjoying my retirement to some degree. I really like to cook, and you know, just kind of enjoying my leisure time. So it's been quite an adjustment.
I think people might want to know when you started thinking about running for city council.
Well, I actually started thinking about it in the spring. And my wife said, you know, you better wait till about July before you really commit one way or another. So I did. And again, I decided to run just because I see some of the things that are going on at council. And I think because of my leadership experience, I'd have a lot to add. So if we have a bunch of new young council members, which we probably will, I think it's a great opportunity for me to mentor and be part of wherever Medicine Hat's going for the next 4 years. So pretty excited about it.
Creating content like this would be impossible without local sponsors like Animal World. Head over there and see Rob at Animal World on Dunmore Road. Get some pet food. Lucky's Grit Dip. I just tried the new Buffalo Ranch and I love it. McBride's Bakery, home of the Big Elvis Donut. Maxwell Network Realty, supporting growth in Medicine Hat.
And what makes you feel like a part of the community?
Well, I guess living here, trying to keep it safe for 41 years, and you know, just all my friends are here. I was actually at one point thinking about retiring back to the area that I grew up, but I always say this is the greatest little place in the world, stuck in the middle of nowhere, and we're not leaving.
What is your religion? Do deities play any role for your decision making?
Well, they didn't, not a large role. I grew up in a small town in Bath, Ontario, and I went to a Catholic school, was raised as a Catholic. And then, like, you know, from there, we kind of, like a lot of, you know, people, they abandoned their religion at one point. And then when we had a young family, we decided to introduce our children to faith, you know, and they could make their own decision as they grew up. So we attended a local Protestant church here for a number of years. So I would call myself spiritual, I will say probably not as spiritual as some would like to see me, but it does play an important role in my life.
In the past 5 years, what do you think the worst decision has been here in the city?
Boy, that's an interesting question, and I think if you were to sum it all up, and I tried to think of city council decisions, it's kind of a strange question, but I think the whole transit thing that happened, it was kind of a bit of a bungle job. They kind of agreed to make a change. I don't know if they engaged the community enough. And, you know, they realized they probably did make a mistake there and reversed it, which I really like, by the way. I mean, I always said that in my former life. You know, if you can reverse a bad decision, if you have the opportunity to do that, which you don't always, but if you do, do it, because usually it's the ego that stands in your way when you don't. So, and you know, we made some decisions, me as the chief in our police service, that, you know, after some time we went, hey, you know what, this isn't working, let's go back to the drawing board. And I think when you can do that and you haven't caused harm to a community, then fair enough, do it.
What do you think of Medicine Hat's skateboarding bylaw? And you might have more to say about this, considering you have some more experience in that.
Well, I don't have a lot to say about it other than, you know, it's an old bylaw. It's 2004 it came into play. And here's what I always say about bylaws. And, you know, some people roll their eyes. I've said it lots. You've got the federal laws. You've got provincial laws. You've got your manners that your mom and dad taught you. And then you've got municipal bylaws in a behavior sense. I know there's a lot of regulatory bylaws. I understand that. But usually these type of bylaws are created because of disruption in the community, you know, people not getting along. Same with dogs on leashes and, you know, defecating in parks, and they're all behavior things. So they usually lack it of some perception of lack of respect. And I would guess, and I can't remember, it's a long time ago, but I know the skateboarders were downtown and creating a lot of noise, and they were on city property and probably the provincial parking, if I remember, and creating a little bit of damage, and I think they were just trying to control that. So it's funny that it hasn't been reviewed since 04, but I don't think it's a bad thing to, I mean, if there's no place for them to go, fine, but as we know, we've got a pretty nice skate park that I think gives them way better opportunity than, you know, some of the things that they would have around on city infrastructure and provincial infrastructure.
Yeah, most people have said, like, if they're using it as a method of transportation, well, it shouldn't fall under the bylaw. Yeah. But if they're jumping on stuff and cracking the edges of things, then certainly it should fall under the bylaw. I guess the bylaw is pretty vague. Yeah. It could probably be updated.
Yeah, it probably could, and that's probably a really good way to look at it. I don't think there were even longboards back then, so, you know, even the type of skateboard that's out is probably a lot different than the ones that were around in 04. So have a look at things. Again, everything's of that kind of nature is reversible.
This one's kind of a cheeky question.
Are they all?
How do you think you get into the quote-unquote old boys club? And I'll give some background on this. Having done stories in Medicine Hat for almost 15 years now, it comes up in the comment section every once in a while that, oh, that's the old boys club at play there. Yeah. Speak to that.
So first, is it referring to council, or just, is that what they mean by the old boys club, or in general?
I think they mean in general, that they mean like there's sort of a maybe a group of families and friends and people that all really know each other really well and look out for each other, and maybe would even go out of their way to look out for each other in a way that they wouldn't for every person in town. Okay. And I guess sometimes they think it relates to government or possibly even policing or possibly all those things. So I think they just sort of want a general of, like, you know, what is that old boys club? What does it mean to you? Do you know it exists? Do you acknowledge it? Or is it a fantasy that people just sort of dream up when they don't like something? Or
no, I think it comes down from people feeling like they're not a part of the say. So I think any old boys club, whether it be actually be boys or men or a group of people, I think when people feel disenfranchised, when they feel not listened to, they'll look at those that are making the decision. I experienced it in my previous life in the police service, both, you know, feeling like I wasn't a part of it and then being accused of being part of it. So I think I understand it. And it really comes from, I guess, inclusivity. Try to be as open, communicate things as best you can, give everybody a say. That's all everybody wants. You know, we all want to be seen, heard, and understood. And I think the more we try to do that, in no matter what area of life we're looking at, you lessen the possibility that people will feel disenfranchised. Because in my mind, that's what they're saying. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think, like, when you say disenfranchised, probably you've had more experience with people and groups that are disenfranchised, so you can see where that leads. And
absolutely, there's no doubt about it. There's, you know, there's groups that feel that they're not getting their say, and you know, that comes back to, I'm sure every council member's probably, or, you know, wannabe council members told you, you know, they want people to feel like they have been heard. And I'm no different about that. It takes commitment, it takes time, and it takes work.
What's the solution for the mental health crisis that's been affecting our community?
Well, that's a bag of nuts. So, as you know, in my life as a police officer, we dealt with mental health issues on an ongoing continual basis, and they do definitely, they're getting worse and worse, and a lot of it is addiction, as we know. So we've got addiction to, you know, first we've got the opioid side of things, which we'll get into safe consumption sites if that's where you'd want to go, but also the methamphetamine and the behavioral issues that are caused by that. So the meth side of the house is super scary for me, because it just doesn't seem like there's a quick solution there. It's an addiction that is it's socially disturbing for those that are addicted and those that aren't, and it's very sad. The opioid issue is a little different, in my view. It's more of a self-destructive issue. They're not as much creating behavioral issues for the community. But again, it's tragic, and we all have seen the examples of people that have died from opioid issues. So what can we do about it? Again, it's a health issue, which is provincial, but I think we set the tone too as a municipality and a city. So it's how we treat people that are addicted. What preventative programs do we set up? And I know from being on the police side of things that the police aren't the magic bullet to all the problems. And, you know, I really learned it in the flood that we had, I think it was 95 or one of them, where we were down the flats trying to get people to leave their residence, and the resistance that we got. So we brought social workers in, and it was like night and day. These social workers came in and really did an awesome job communicating. So the big lesson for me out of that one was, you know what, we can't control all things. So we have to be really careful, really, that we're inclusive, that we bring other people that are experts in. And so the province, I think, has tried really hard. As we know, there's a financial issue right now with, you know, money, but this is something that's not going to go away until we really put our heads together and work on it. But it is totally a community issue. It's not the police need to fix it. It's not the health staff need to. We all need to come together on it. And the municipality needs to play a role as well. It doesn't have to be financial. It could be just leadership-wise, you know, acknowledging there's an issue and helping be a part of the solution.
Outside of the drug side of that whole crisis, I think there's also there's been suicides at levels we haven't seen before. And what I'm hearing is that, you know, Medicine Hat had like 5 psychiatrists, and I think we're getting down to 3 or something like that. So I'm also just wondering about the whole mental health side of things just in general, because there's lots of people that, you know, they're not experiencing the drug thing. They're experiencing the depression side of things, I guess.
Well, truly. And you look at, you know, so I was still at the police service when we had a lot of those suicides where there were a bunch of young men that all were kind of knew each other, and it was terrifying because it seemed to have a link, and we looked so hard for what is the link here.
It's like it's contagious or
that's
something.
I know, and I don't. It's something that we'd never really experienced here in this community. Yeah. You know, so was it the pandemic, the stresses of all that were going on, combined with all the other stresses that we had? Like, so there's, you know, I knew some of those guys, and my son, who was the same age as a few of them, you know, we played on hockey teams that he did with them, and baseball teams, and, you know, to watch it happen, I would phone some of my folks that were more in touch with those people when I was in my other role, and saying, you know, what do we got here? What is the link? And so, yes, there is that other piece. So, you know, more psychologists, less, again, not my bailiwick, but we do need to support having, you know, the proper medical folks in place. And again, what I think when the curb started to change is when the community got together and started having open houses and people that had some of the same issues and experiences got up and spoke, that you shocked you to see who they were, and that they were brave enough to get up and say, hey, you know what, I've struggled with those issues. So it's creating a safe environment for everybody to say, hey, you know, and we've seen some very, you know, some strong celebrity type folks that have came out and said, you know, I struggled. I think back to Sheldon Kennedy and the, you know, what he did. He came out and spoke about sexual abuse and how impacting that was, and then Fleury to follow him. And it's those kind of people. So I don't have the answers for it, but I know as a community we have to acknowledge it's there and not close our eyes to it and look where we can help.
Community TV's election coverage would not be possible without the generous sponsorship of businesses like Gravity Sports. Ben helped me build this tall bike that you might see me riding around every once in a while, and the staff down there know just about everything you could want to know about repairing your bicycle, so bring it down there if you need some help. And of course, Gold Dust Jewelry. Johan and I have been friends for quite a while, and while he's moved out of the retail business, he's still doing custom jewelry out of his home studio. And if you need to get a hold of him, just contact his Facebook page or send him an email, and he'll be able to make you a custom piece of jewelry, just about anything you can imagine, and probably deliver it right to your house. Also want to thank Truckers. 24/7 business on the highway that just about everybody has known for the last 20, 30 years. It's been around longer than I've been around. Truckers Restaurant, it's a great place to stop and have a meal anytime you need one, and it's just like a home-cooked meal. Really special. The staff there are great, and they've always got a cool dessert to try. Sponsoring Community TV's content is a cost-effective return on investment for your business and a great way to show that you care about the community. So if you'd like to get your logo here, please contact me. My email is tom@comtv.ca.
How does Andy McGrogan qualify? What does homeless mean? Like, what is it?
Well, yeah, I've talked to some people that are the experts of that area here in the city. We have a great infrastructure here already that are working on homeless. And again, I asked one of them in particular, probably that deals with it on a full-time basis. And her answer was, acknowledge that it's there and stay out of the way when we're trying to actually, you know, create change. And one thing I really liked about what she had to say is, with homelessness, you know, to get people into homes, the other part of that is their responsibility to that, and make it so that it's a shared effort between the homeless and the people that are providing the housing. I really like that. I guess my view is people that help themselves, for generally, you know, they're more apt to succeed. Mm-hmm. And so I think supporting that, and like she said, stay out of the way. And let the provincial folks that know what they're doing, and a lot of our not-for-profit agencies in town are very good at it as well. And so giving them the support, acknowledging their importance, and you know, again, supporting all of our agencies, including the police.
What should the city be doing about truth and reconciliation?
So globally, I'm going to say that it is a big issue, and I want to use the word enraged, but I just have to wonder if when they started digging up all those bodies, and if they were white babies in those graves, what we'd be doing and how outraged would we be as a community right now. And so we don't have a residential school here where we're, you know, finding graves, but we still have a strong Indigenous and Métis, especially, population in the community. And I know in my previous life, we had an awesome relationship with the Mawasan Center and that group, and participated. We actually had a lady named Holly Fournier came down and spoke to all of our police officers and gave an amazing 4-hour presentation around the history of the Indigenous and the residential schools and the impact that they had. And this is before we were digging up these bodies. And I was actually embarrassed as a chief of police that I knew as little as I did about the Indian Act and about residential schools. And I went up to her after she was done, first talking to the Alberta chiefs that I was at. That's where I got her here. And I told her, I said, I'm embarrassed with how little I know about this, being a chief of police. And I swore at that day that I would never drive through a reserve and feel the same way again. And I think if we all will open our eyes and not stereotype, really be open to what happened. And there's some great programs, you know, that are out there right now, that if you want to become informed, there's one on Netflix that I'm telling people all the time, watch this, right? So it's becoming aware, being educated, and supporting our Indigenous and Métis communities. I mean, why not? And if you look at the report that came out, there's things in that report, and one of the things, you know, again, was having an Indigenous representation at different levels, including police commission. And I don't know what we've done to do that, but I support it 100%.
And we'll get back to, I guess, the one we had talked about a bit before with the drug consumption stuff. I mean, while you were chief, it was discussed we could have the safe consumption site. But then sort of things happened with the government change and a review of the thing, and it ended up going away. Yeah. If that was back on the table, is it something that you support, or do you have anything to say about safe consumption sites?
Sure. So I sat on the committee of the folks that wanted to bring it here. So I'm on record of supporting safe consumption. But safe consumption has to come with with more. It has to come with, okay, how can we get into rehabilitation? So just to give people a safe place to consume doesn't make sense to me. But offering services to get people off of, and use most cases of safe consumption, is opioid-related drugs. So I do think that there is a place for safe consumption, but it has to be followed up with services that get people off. And I went to Lethbridge and watched and toured the safe consumption site. I wouldn't want that here. I wouldn't want that model here in Medicine Hat. So the location and how that happened, I think, was wrong. The way it kind of died and then all of a sudden it popped up in another area of town, I think the citizens were shocked. So it wasn't handled right again. It's back to open, transparent, ongoing communication. I don't want to sound cliche, but I absolutely mean it. It's back to the old boys club. If you don't inform people and you just spring on them that, you know, your next door neighbor is now a safe consumption site, you're going to get fear. Like I've always said, you know, it's hard to love the unlovely, and we don't want them next to us. But if we really think about what we can do to solve the problem, safe consumption is okay if it's coupled with rehabilitation and all the things that follow.
Just gonna check real quick here. Yeah, we're doing great.
Oh, is there an issue that we haven't discussed yet that you wanted to talk about, and how will you approach solving that issue?
Well, I think there's a few big issues that we haven't talked about. One of them is GenCo and the sale of City Utilities, which I think, again, it's a hugely complicated. I've been trying to become informed on what it is, what it looks like. And I think the citizens are, again, feeling that there wasn't enough consultation and community discussion around that. And I personally agree. I think it should have been more, you know, here are the risk factors and here are the benefits. It's kind of like, I have a bad analogy, and it's like having a beautiful antique car in your driveway that you never take care of, and the tires go flat and it gets rusty. Are we keeping an eye on what we have? Are we treating it like an asset that we need into our future? With carbon taxes, again, I'm a little out of my realm right now. Do we need to be diversifying to some renewables so we get green credits? Because sooner or later, the carbon taxes that we use to use gas to create electricity are going to make it so it's not viable. So what are we doing about that? And I'm not saying solar panels or wind turns of the issue, but the answer, but I do think that we need to keep an eye on it. Technology is screaming forward, and we need to be looking at that asset and looking at how we can augment it, and looking at the carbon tax situation, looking at our gas supply, because if we're buying gas off the grid, you know, again, I'm not an expert in the area, but I will say we need experts that we trust at City Hall, the bureaucrats, our city manager, and, you know, our guy that's in charge of our utilities, to really be good, and then bring in people that know what they're talking about and make a decision that's informed and that's discussed in the community. That's what I hear the community wants. Discuss this before you let an asset that's emotionally very important to people. The other aspect is the recreational plan. So there's talk about a 4-quad sheet of ice up in Briar Park or in Southridge or whatever, and it's creating some emotional fever right now as well. And again, what are we talking about? What are we telling the community about? Let's take Crescent Heights, the arena up there. And again, I don't know, I'm just using it as an example. Let's say it's completely outdated and it's going to cost a fortune to fix it up, because we all know that was an outdoor rink that we decided to put a building around, and then we put dressing rooms on it, and we did all these things. So is having two or three sheets together in different areas of town more cost effective, and why are we afraid to look at that? And the other thing, from just talking to people, they really like is they love the neighborhood outdoor pool. So I think we should be careful there that we don't go too far into that area, because that's a thing. I still see people using them all the time, but it's been a long time since I saw a kid walking down the street with his hockey bag walking to a rink. I mean, they're all getting driven. So
So
how do we come up with an idea? Because the bottom line is the bottom line.
Yeah.
The city only has so much revenue,
yep,
and they have so much in expenses. So how do we equal them off? What are the things we have to trade? And again, what do the citizens want us to trade?
The question too is, like, you need to know what the citizens want. What might be the best way to find that out? Because I found that maybe over the years, there's been sometimes they'll put out a survey, yeah, and then it could get back the results and it's like, oh, 1,200 people filled out the survey.
Yeah.
You know, like, how do we actually get people to engage anyhow?
Well, see it again in my past life, we tried continually. Even things like open houses, we thought, oh, we're going to, you know, there's going to be tons of people that show up. But we had one on Photo Radar, and very few people showed up to the actual consultation process. So you're right. But I think giving people the opportunity to at least give their input, however it may be, whether it be town hall, whether it be, as you know, in a survey, a scientifically rigorous survey that you can prove is scientifically rigorous, you don't need the full sample of the community, you just need a proportionate share of the community. So there's different ways to go about it. And social media is another area now that's really helping us hear what people are thinking.
And then the last question is sort of about me. What do you think of community TV or any videos you've seen that I've made or anything that you've seen that I've done? This is your chance to give me feedback directly to me and I'll tell everybody else what you said.
Well, before I answer that, are you going to put my sign up in your front yard? I'm kidding you.
He's putting me on the spot. He's putting me on the spot. You know what? I think I might.
So I of course checked out your site. I think you reach a demographic and a group of folks that maybe aren't on mainstream type media. So I appreciate that. I see some of your sponsors and respect them. So you know, I think you're heading in the right direction. I think you are. I told you off camera, I think that you are, I don't want to say maturing, because I'm not saying that you're ever immature, but you're
come on, yeah.
Okay, yeah, you have been. But it seems to me that you're asking good questions, and like this interview is probably a great example. I don't know if you would have had an interview similar to this 5 years ago, so I appreciate that.
Right on. Yeah. Well, thanks for hanging out with me.
Yeah.
You have a great afternoon, Andy.
You too.
Right on.
Thanks again for watching my Community TV 2021 Medicine Hat Municipal Election coverage. And more of the sponsors of Community TV include Hemptown Rock in downtown Medicine Hat. And Patty's doing big things there. So go see her on Railway in downtown Medicine Hat if you need some glassware, if you know what I mean. And then, of course, if you have ever been accused of something, you need the best defense. And the best defense in Medicine Hat is Yarshenko and Heidinger Law Office. Call my buddy Lyndon Heidinger over there and ask him how he can best defend you. There are plenty more spaces for sponsorships on Community TV, so if you want to see your ad somewhere in this municipal election coverage, just contact me, Tom@comtv.ca. Thanks again for watching.